So we had kind of a weird trade, but I think a good one for the Saints' perspective. They're getting Kwon Alexander, who is a Pro Bowl linebacker. They give up Kiko Alonso, who has had some good years with the Saints, one good year in particular with the Saints, and they also give up a fifth-round pick. This is definitely an upgrade. I mean, Alexander is, you know, it's kind of a position of need. They could use another linebacker, and he is someone who can play well. I'll get into what he's good at and what he's not so good at in just a second, but also you got to mention the contracts. I mean, you know, the one thing that I hear a lot of people talking about is that the Saints are already going to be so far over the cap next year, and now they're taking on another big contract. But actually, at the end of this year, Alexander, his contract isn't going to be that bad. Most of his contract was from his signing bonus. His cap hit this year is only about $1 million, and while his cap hit would be $13 million next year, it's only going to be $13 million if they keep him. They can easily just get rid of him, and then the dead cap is only going to be $4 million, which isn't nothing, but it's not a big deal. So it basically seems like a guarantee that it's just a one-year deal for Kwon Alexander. But, you know, they're basically, since they got rid of Alonso, they're basically splitting the difference. I mean, Alonso is getting paid just as much as Kwon Alexander is for this year. And basically, it just means that you have to cut him or trade him in the offseason. So, yeah, that's the contract side of things. Now let's just get into how he is as a player. The best thing about his game is his run defense. He's an incredible run stopper. This is why he's a Pro Bowler. Honestly, if he covered as well as he played run defense, he'd be an All-Pro. He's incredible. And let's just get it started with this play. One of the things he is so good at are plays like this, where a guard's going to pull around and block Alexander. That's the way this play is going to work for Arizona. And so right when this play starts, you're going to notice that he gets in pretty good position to block Alexander. But this is really where Kwon can shine. Kwon is great in these moments. And one of the things that, you know, I do think matters is the fact that Kwon Alexander used to play running back. So he kind of knows how to look and find a gap and shoot through it just as much as an opposing running back does. And so that's what he's going to do. Watch how he shoots through that gap and is even able to make a pretty good tackle. I'm going to get into that in a second. His tackling ability isn't always the best necessarily, although this time it definitely worked out. And that's really what he can do. He's just incredible at reading the plays and finding the gaps and trying to get through and making a play. He's also just incredible at realizing what's going on quickly. He doesn't hesitate. He figures out where he has to go and he figures out what he has to do to make a play. And this next one is going to be a great example of that. So the way it works is that there's going to be a right guard and right tackle who double team an interior defensive lineman. Then the guard's going to get off the block, run over and try to block Alexander. That's the way this play works. It's a pretty simple concept. But, you know, the one advantage for New York is that, because this is the Jets that are playing, the one advantage for them is that they can get the double team, but then still not have to waste a block. And basically the idea is that the guard finishes off the double team, moves up, and blocks Alexander. The only real drawback in this type of thing is that sometimes it does take a little bit longer to get going, although typically it's not a problem, and typically this is something you'll see on just about every running play. But once this ball is snapped, watch how Alexander just completely gets through there. And that's what I'm talking about with his quick reads. He reads these plays so quickly and is able to get through that gap to now at this point, you're kind of in a tough situation if you're an offensive lineman where you want to try and block him out of the way. But obviously, you can't block him too much because if you grab on, that'll be a holding penalty and you're pushing your own team 10 yards backwards. Alexander is able to run over and make a very quick tackle for a loss. Just an incredible play. And that's what Alexander can do. That's what he's capable of. And that's what he'll bring to this New Orleans Saints defense where they really could have used an extra linebacker. And he's someone that'll be good in that situation. The one drawback for Kwon Alexander is that this is by far and away what he's the best at. And while I think he is good enough in coverage that he's worth keeping on the field, he's not terrible enough that he's worth keeping on the field because of his great run defense, no one's going to confuse him for a great coverage linebacker. This plays a great example. It's going to be zone coverage. This is a cover two zone. The blue circle that you see, that's where Alexander is. That's the zone he's in charge of covering. And there is going to be a New York player who is running into his zone. And obviously, you know, on one hand, you look at this kind of route and say, well, that's not good because it's right in Alexander's zone. But at the same time, if you can get open without using much space, it can still work out, you know, because it essentially is just a man-on-man coverage, which is still possible to get open on. Once this play starts, you notice Alexander, I feel like too far in. He overcommits in coverage, and I think that's kind of his problem, where in the running game, it's basically just once you figure out what's going on, you just break in that direction, whereas in the passing game, you kind of have to make sure you don't overshoot where you're supposed to go, because that can often result in someone else just making another quick move and getting open. That's kind of Alexander's problem a little bit, is he will make his decisions very quickly in coverage. Obviously, it works out well in the running game. It can work out poorly in the passing game. You're going to see a nice spin move get pulled on Alexander, but also he just got fooled pretty badly, and that results in a nice catch, nice gain for the New York Jets. Nothing crazy, but that's kind of what he is in coverage. No one's going to confuse him for a great coverage linebacker. He's also not so bad at coverage that you can't play him. He's very much playable, and again, because of how good he is in the running game, he's worth having on the field, even if he is lackluster in coverage, but it is worth bringing up. And last but not least, the other thing you have to talk about when talking about Kwon is his tackling ability. He's just not the best tackler. He just isn't. It's unfortunate, but he, amazingly, despite the fact that he is such a good run stopper, he isn't an incredible tackler, and it does sometimes cost them. This is an example of that. So there's going to be a little switch block here where it's actually going to be the tight end, who's the tight end furthest to the left side of the screen. He's the one who's going to be blocking Alexander on this play, and they're just kind of twisting around to try to give their back a better angle. It's not going to work out too well, but that's what they're trying to do. Once this play starts, you notice that a tight end is blocking Alexander to a certain gap. Another defensive back did a pretty good job of actually clogging up the gap that New York initially wanted to have their halfback run through. So now he's going to have to run through the gap where Alexander is already positioned in. And Alexander is in great position. This is what you want to be. I think it's a fair argument to say that some of Alexander's teammates to his right didn't do a great enough job of closing up that gap on the other side, but that's okay. He's still in decent position. However, Alexander reaches his arm out. He creates contact, but isn't able to actually make that tackle. And that's kind of the thing about Alexander, is he isn't the best tackler. You know, some of those plays where it's kind of more difficult, it's hard to blame him too much, but he also still wasn't able to make that play. And there will be plenty of times as well, just in open field, where he completely misses a tackle, and it's a problem. It is a problem. Is it a big problem? No, it isn't. And in fact, even with the missed tackles he'll have, he gets to so many players so much that even though you notice the missed tackles, he's still so incredible that he is able to get there. You kind of almost notice it more. I've made this comparison before, but he's kind of like one of those shortstops in baseball that's really good at getting to the ball, but isn't necessarily the best at like scooping it and making a throw to first. So their value is still higher because of how many they get to, but they will make more errors and you will notice them more because they're getting to the ball more. Alexander's kind of the same way. You notice his missed tackles more because he's constantly getting in position to make a tackle. In fact, this is somebody who has led the league in solo tackles in his career before, so he has that capability. The other thing worth mentioning, he's coming off an injury, so who knows how healthy he will be. And honestly, that's kind of been the question following Alexander his whole career. That's another one of his negatives. That's probably his biggest negative, is just health. He's gotten injured every year except for, I believe, one or two in his entire career. And so that's a real problem. And those start to add up too. And you got to just hope that he can stay healthy if you're a Saints fan. So for the Saints, I like this move. You're getting a Pro Bowl caliber player for a fifth round pick and a linebacker who you're not going to use anymore because of your now addition of a Pro Bowl caliber player. You are kind of a bit more so going all out to try and win a Super Bowl this year, but you know what? I like that. Why not try and win a Super Bowl when you have a championship contending squad? And for San Francisco, it's kind of a weird one, to be honest. I feel like San Francisco is still in the playoff hunt, so to get rid of Alexander, it kind of makes you wonder why they even signed him in the first place, because they just signed him, you know, not last offseason, but the offseason before. So just kind of a weird move for them. I don't really get it. I don't know. I mean, you have a good player. I guess they're just, maybe the injuries are the problem. I don't know. Kind of a weird one. Don't really get it from San Francisco, but you know what? I mean, I guess it's weird because I don't know why you'd want Kiko Alexander. It almost feels like you're just doing New Orleans a favor. And for a fifth round pick, I'd rather just keep Alexander, especially because you could cut him next year. Maybe their plan is to get rid of him and they'd rather give him up so at least they don't have to pay the few million in dead cap next year. I don't know. Doesn't make sense to me, but maybe there's a reason I'm not thinking of. That's what I think. What do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below. Always love hearing from you. And of course, as always, thanks for watching.